that I would just be off in my own little world. And you know, just, I remember every time, it kind of reminds me of when I'm driven down to Calgary. When I was in seminary, I was an associate pastor at Northport Baptist Church at the time, and what I would do is we had class from Tuesday until Friday. And so Tuesday morning, every Tuesday morning, I always had an 8 o'clock class. And for the last 2 years of seminary, that was either Greek or Hebrew, so which was brutal anyways, but and to have it in the first class of the week was even worse. But what I would do is I'd get up at roughly at 4 o'clock in the morning on Tuesday morning and drive to class. So when you complain about getting up early and going to class, I won't give you any sympathy. But I would get up on Tuesday morning and go to class. So get up at 4 o'clock and go to class for my 8 o'clock class and be there Tuesday morning. And then I would come home on Friday evening after I finished classes and be with Gardell. And at that time, Angelina and Matt and Alexander. Didn't exist yet. And so we would be, that would be my routine every week. And I would drive down, and there would be times as I was driving down the road that I couldn't even tell you what I passed. I couldn't remember what part of the, if I had driven all the way down, this, I couldn't tell you anything about the trip. I was in that sort of just driving mode, right? You do it all the time. You're in that same, going that same direction. Nothing seems to change. It's like you're in a trance. Now, I've been a Christian now for nearly, 37 years. And some of you aren't even close to that age yet, right? So I've been a Christian for a long time. I've gone through many different stages of my faith. I've been a super Bible thumper. You know, if you came and knew me when I was in college, I was a super conservative guy that had no, there was, everything was very black and white, there was no gray, there was no, you know, there was no shades at all, different colors. It was just this way or no, or that way, and that's how it was. So I've gone through that stage of my life, and I don't know if you've ever heard of people called Bible thumpers before, but that's what I would have been called. I've been through times when I've struggled as a Christian. I didn't know what I was doing, what I believed. I didn't know which way to turn, or where to go for answers, any of those things. I've been the needy Christian, the one who needs to tell everybody their problems, the one who needs to have everybody feel sorry for them, the one who needs. You know what I mean? Maybe you've experienced that too. I've been the backslidden Christian, the one who's just sort of in that off in that part that I just, you know, I don't really care. I don't care what you're doing. I don't care what they're doing. I couldn't care less if I'm at church or not at church, all that kind of stuff. And I've also been the lukewarm Christian. The one who just, you know, is not that bad a guy. Who does, goes to church. Everybody likes him. You know, he might even teach Sunday school. He might lead music. He might do all kinds of different things. Might even be a deacon in the church. Because I've done all those things. And people think that you got it all together. And that you're really on fire. But really, you're just going a long way. This morning, we're going to look at a passage. In this passage, we're going to see how Jesus challenged us to examine our faith. You know, we have a multitude of Christians that live in this world with the illusion that I talk the talk and go to church, everything will be okay. So the title of my message this morning is Living the Illusion. And you know, it's an easy place to get to. It's easy mode to get into, because it's just like being on cruise control in your car. But Jesus in this passage is going to make it clear that this will not do any longer in your life, in my life, or any of our lives. It's time for us to wake up and smell coffee, so to speak. I hate coffee, but you know, it's always good. Coffee, it does smell good in the morning. It's time for us to wake up and smell coffee. It's time for us to get alive and be awakened in our faith. We must start to see things as they are and stop living an illusion that good enough is, or just good enough is going to cut it. When I was in school from grade 1 to 12, I learned to do just enough. So when I was in elementary school from grade 1 to 6, we didn't have kindergarten. Kindergarten was still optional. It was like going to preschool. But from grade 1 to 6, I was perfect at getting C's and S's. I don't even think we give C's and S's anymore. But S's were satisfactory, right? And I lived in that role, you know, satisfactory. I sat sort of in the middle of the class. I never sat at the back. I wasn't one of those kids. And I certainly was not going to sit at the front because I wasn't going to be one of those kids either. But I was satisfactory. I was that middle of the road kid. I just did enough to get S's. And I had my parents convinced that that's all I could do. And so when I got into junior high school, when I got C's, they thought, great. Look, Dennis is getting C's. He didn't need to do any better. That's all he can do. That's all he's good enough at. So I was that lukewarm student. And I got to high school, I got C's just so I could play football or rugby. And, if I didn't have that kind of grade, my parents wouldn't let me play because they were convinced that's all I was good enough to do. You know, we live like that as parents, too. As Christians, we get like in that mode, too. So not only did I convince my parents, I had a teacher's fool. I had, when it came down, I had myself fooled, too. And that was my best. And as I told you, and I've shared with you about how well I did when I first started college, I learned that C's couldn't cut it anymore. And in fact, I had to put in some work. And finally, when I went back to college and figured it out, and I did quite a bit better, it was trust. I had to learn to trust God and ask God to help me through these times and to return and to be a little more on fire and put in the work and put in the effort. I couldn't just be lukewarm. Because lukewarm didn't cut it. Christians, it's just not good enough to be good enough. The Bible calls this lukewarm and to be just good enough. We need to know and learn how God sees lukewarm. And that's what we're going to see today as we look at this passage in Luke, in Revelation chapter 3, verses 14 through 22. It's a letter that Jesus wrote through John to the church of Laodicea. A church that was in an area that was very affluent, a church that was in an area of the world that had everything they needed. As we'll see as we look at this passage. But before we do that, let's begin with the word of prayer as we begin our study this morning of God's word. Heavenly Father, just thank you for this day and thank you for the opportunity that we have to worship you this morning. Lord, I thank you for how you love each one of us and how you sent your son to the cross so that each one of us could be here and experience your love. Lord, I pray this morning as we continue in our worship time, as we look into your word, that you would open our hearts to your message, that you'd make us aware of how we need to make adjustments in our lives, and that we would do that this morning. I pray for these things now in your son's precious name, in Jesus Christ. Amen. Now this morning, as we look at this passage, we're just going to go walk our way through it. The last couple of weeks, I felt like we just need to walk through some passages, and we're going to continue to do that this morning. As we look at Revelation chapter 3, let's begin in verse 14 and 15. It says, "To the angel of the church in Laodicea write." So to the angels, the messenger of the church, so to the people of the church, he says, "The Amen are faithful, the faithful and true witness of the orator, or originator, right, of God's creation," he says. So he's saying, this is Jesus talking to the church. This is Jesus talking to the people of the church of Laodicea. In verse 15 it says, "I know your works, that you are neither cold nor hot. And I wish you were cold or hot." So what is Jesus telling his people there about to the lukewarm Christians? He's telling them that you know, you're neither hot nor cold. So you're neither an atheist. You'd rather than be an atheist. And you're neither hot. You're just this lukewarm thing. Have you ever taken a lukewarm bath or a lukewarm shower? It's terrible. Have you ever had lukewarm coffee or lukewarm soup? It's awful. You want it warm, or nowadays you want coffee hot or cold, right? Lukewarm is gross. So Jesus is telling us here in this passage that, you know, you're not either one. You're hot, you're not hot, you're not cold. You're this something in the middle that's just nasty, for lack of a better term. Who wants to be nasty? Who wants to be just average? You know, most of us, we're not going to be great orators. We're not going to be mighty men of faith or women of faith. We're not going to be what we think of as Paul or Peter. We're not going to be those individuals like that. We're not necessarily going to be the next Billy Graham. We're not going to be the next Corey Ten Boom or the next Lottie Moon or Annie Armstrong, all these different offerings that you know that we have. We're not going to be invested in those people in our minds, but Jesus doesn't want us to be just lukewarm. And he goes on in verse 16 and says, in verse 16 and 17, he says, so because of you are lukewarm and neither hot nor cold, now listen to this, my version, some versions say I'm going to spew you out of my mouth. It says, I'm going to vomit you out of my mouth. Now that's just nastiness altogether, isn't it? So, now most of us here have stomach flu, I'm sure, at some point. And when you get sick and you want to get that out of your system and you go to the washroom, that's the picture I get here, right? It's like, it's just nastiness, right? You want to get rid of it. And that's what Jesus is saying. It's making him literally sick. That we are just lukewarm, that we're just comfortable being in cruise control, that we're just comfortable just doing the average, just being okay. We're just comfortable just talking about being a Christian. We're comfortable about singing about being a Christian. We're comfortable preaching about being a Christian. We're comfortable about all these different things. And he's saying, this makes me literally sick that you're like this. Great picture, isn't it? Now, I want you to realize that I believe that all the churches I've been at, this is probably our biggest problem in our churches today, is lukewarm Christianity. The reason our churches are not growing, the reason our churches are not reaching people for Christ, is because we're full of lukewarm Christians. At one time, we used to call these people that are on just the edge. They're at church, they're in Sunday school, they're participating, but that's all that they're doing. We call them Sunday Christians. We're playing the game, we're playing church, and it's not making a difference in this world. That's not the kind of Christian I want to be. And that's not the kind of Christian that Christ wants us to be. It says, because you say, in verse 17, because you say, I am rich, I have become wealthy, I need nothing. And you don't know that you are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked. So he's saying, you think that you got it all together. Most of us here in this room are not that poor. Most of us in this room have the clothes that we like, we have the cars that we like, we have the life that we like, we're going to school, we have, I'll be honest with you, there's probably, most of us here would say there's some things that we like, Louis Vuitton, or we like, Donna Care. I don't know all the different, am I thinking about the right words? I can't think about fashion stuff. There's things that we see out there that we might like to have, but the reality is most of us are pretty comfortable. We have nice clothes, we have a nice home, we have a nice bed to sleep in at night, we have a pretty good life in general. And what Jesus is telling us though is, you get in that mold, you think that you're okay, you think you don't need me, but you know what? Christian is telling us that in reality, you're wretched, you're pitiful, you're blind, you're poor and naked. In the cathedral in Lübeck, Germany, there's an inscription that says this. You call me master, and obey me not. You call me light, and see me not. You call me way, and walk me not. You call me life, and choose me not. You call me wise, and follow me not. You call me fair, and love me not. You call me rich, and ask me not. You call me eternal, and seek me not. You call me noble, and serve me not. You call me gracious, and trust me not. You call me just, and fear me not. If I condemn you, blame me not. Isn't that so true? We talk about a mighty God. We sing about an everlasting Savior. We sing of the cross. We preach of the cross. We talk about living the life. Yet, do we? What happens in your life this week, or that last week after you left the service? What happens here in your life after you heard the Sunday school lesson? What happens in your life after Sunday until next Sunday? Now, I'm not here to just judge you. I'm not here to beat you up. I'm not here to make you feel terrible. What I want you to just think about, though, is, am I just like cruise control? Am I just living in an illusion of being a believer? Am I just being sort of a Christian? Am I living this life and thinking that I just got it all made and I don't need a change? And Jesus is saying, are you wretched? You're pitiful, you're poor, you're blind and naked. And let's go on though, because if he just stopped there, I would be worried, right? But Jesus goes on and he continues in this letter and he tells us in verse 18, I advise you to buy from me gold refined in the fire so that you may be rich, and white clothes so that you may be dressed and your shameful nakedness not be exposed, and ointment to spread on your eyes so that you may see. As many as I love, I rebuke and discipline. So be committed and repent. He talks about buying gold refined. Now, what does this sort of indicate? Well, most commentaries have suggested they're talking about the righteous character found only in a life committed to Christ. So that those things that are meaningless, those things that are not important, are burned away. Those things like that we build our lives upon, like things that the world sees as important, like clothes and cars and houses and so forth, and all these different things. These things that we see as very important, but in reality, what is important is that we are clothed, that we are striving for the things that are important, that make a difference. That's Christ's righteousness. Let Him refine our lives. Let's burn away those things and let the gold refined that is found in Christ, His gold. And then it says white clothes. Now it's interesting that in this set passage here, he talks about white clothes because in Laodicea, they had in the past that they were well known for a dark, rich colored black or dark, maybe dark blue or purple kind of idea clothing that they produced in their city. So when he says now instead of that, because they clothed themselves in that, and they were pretty proud of the fact that where they came from and that's what they wore. So, but he's telling them, put away those things, let them put on the white clothes that I have for you to cover your nakedness or your self-righteousness, to cover up that emptiness. Put on what I have to hold you in. Put on what I have for you in your life. And then he goes on and he says, and ointment to spread on your eyes that you may see. He wants them to come and to realize, he wants to show them how he wants to change your life. He wants to make their life complete. He wants to give them direction. He wants to make them more than just lukewarm. He wants to make them hot and on fire for God. And in verse 19, right, it says, and as many as I love you are rebuke and discipline, so be committed and repent. Committed. Are you committed? You say, I committed my life to Christ. I gave my life to Christ. I'm making Him Lord of my life. Do you understand what you're saying when you say those words? Another word for committed might be zeal in some passages, in some translations. What is zeal? What it means? Enthusiastic, keen, passionate, fervent, ardent, fanatical, obsessive, eager, extreme. Are you extreme for Christ? Are you eager for Christ? Are you obsessed for Christ? Are you fanatical? Now, sometimes we use the word fanatical as a very negative word, but what I want us to be is fanatical Christians. Can you imagine us being fanatical? Now, what is the word fanatical? How do we see the word fanatical used today? Well, how many of us are Oilers fans? How many of us are Eskimo fans? How many of us are New York Yankee fans? Whatever these things. I love watching hockey. I love watching the Oilers. And even though I'm not sure what they're going to do this year, in my heart, I want to be a fanatical fan who says, yeah, they're going to win the Stanley Cup this year. And they probably won't. But I have that hope. You know, it'd be great to see one day again. I'm a fanatic about the Oilers. I'm a fanatic about the Eskimos. Just ask my wife when she's upstairs and she hears me yelling at the TV because they had another interception or that the other team scored another foot or another touchdown. I'm pretty much fanatical. But when I hear someone stand and is negative about my Lord, am I fanatical? Or do I just sit there quietly? I don't want them to know. When I hear someone use the name of Jesus as a swear word, do I just go, that's okay. I don't want them to know I'm a Christian. I don't want to embarrass you. I don't want to give you a hard time. This morning, I just want us to think. Because verse 20 and 21 really tugs at my heart. Often we use verse 20 as a passage talking to non-Christians, but you know what? It's a passage talking to Christians. Listen, you've probably heard this. Listen, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I'll come into him and have dinner with him and he with me. The victor, I'll give him the right to sit with me on the throne, just as I also won the victory and sat down with my Father on his throne. God wants to give you the victory. He's standing at the heart of your door, knocking and knocking and knocking and knocking and saying, please open the door. Let me in. Let me come in today. Let me be in your life. Let me be a part of your life. And if you know what we're talking about, non-Christians, that makes sense. You know, we want to invite him into our hearts. But in this sense, here he's talking to you and I who are believers in Jesus Christ. Behold, I stand. Anyone, just let me in. I will come in and have dinner, sit down and eat with them. I will fellowship with him. I will walk with him. I will be with him. The victory. The victory is his. The victor. He is the victor, and I will give him the right to sit with me on the throne. God wants us to be on fire. He wants us to be victorious, glorious. God is not interested in our illusion that many of us are trying to pass off as Christian. Having been acting like you have made, or maybe you have put on the appearance of a person that has it all together, but God knows what's going on in the inside. He knows the real you. He knows the real me. We see individuals like this that have it all together, but God sees the lukewarm Christian that plays the game as we call church. Jesus is standing at the door knocking, asking you to let him come in. Let him plead you, to free you, to give you truth. Will you let him come in? So him called the Savior is waiting. And I could sing it for you, I suppose, but I won't sing it for you. I'll read it to you. It says, the Savior is waiting to enter your heart. Why don't you let him come in? There's nothing in this world to keep you apart. What is your answer to him? If you'll take one step toward the Savior, my friend, you'll find his arms open wide. Receive him and all the darkness will end. In your heart, he'll abide. Time
after time he's waiting before. And now he's waiting again to see if you're willing to open the door. Oh, how he wants to come in. 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 5, we read, test yourself to see if you are in the faith. Examine yourself, or do you not recognize for yourself that Jesus Christ is in you, unless you fail the test? Is Christ in you? In one of the commentaries, they gave this little example of a letter that a pastor put in a bulletin one time. I'm going to read that to you also this morning. It says, Dear Jane, I'm writing to help you shake this feeling of uselessness that has overcome you. Several times you said that you don't see how Christ could possibly use you. The church must bear part of the responsibility for making you feel as you do. I have in mind the success story mentally of the church. Our church periodically tells you the story of John J. Moneybags, who has an influential position to witness for Christ. At the church youth bank, we have a testimony from All-American football star Ofsky, who commands the respect of his teammates when he witnesses for Christ. We are led to think that if you don't have leverage or stardom or a big position in the business world, you might as well keep your mouth shut. Nobody cares what Christ has done for you. We've forgotten an elementary fact about Christian witness, something that should encourage you. God has chosen what the world calls foolish to shame the wise. He has chosen what the world calls weak to shame the strong. He has chosen the things of little strength and of small repute, yes, even the things that have no real existence to explode in the pretentious of the things that are, that no man may boast in the presence of God. Now listen to this paragraph. He says, when Jesus Christ chose his disciples, he didn't choose Olympic champs or Roman senators. He chose simple people like you. Some were fishermen, and one was a political extremist. Another was a publican, a nobody in that society. But these men turned the Roman world upside down for Christ. How did they do it? Through their popularity? They had none. Through their position? They had none. Their power was the power of Christ through the Holy Spirit. Jane, don't forget that we still need the ordinary in the hands of Christ to turn the world upside down. Maybe the reason you feel like you're just been living a lukewarm life is because you feel like you have nothing to offer. Nothing to offer our church, nothing to offer Jesus Christ. But I want you to understand this morning that all through history, Christ has taken the ordinary and done the extraordinary. God has taken the average and done the above average. God has taken the ones who no one thinks can do anything and done amazing things. Now, I don't think of myself as extraordinary or amazing or done those kind of things necessarily. But I do believe that when I look at myself, a person that I remember sitting in a church down in Calgary one time and everyone was taking a verse to read through in the class that we often do in Sunday school. And as I stood to read my passage, I stumbled through the passage and I had a hard time reading, and I remember the kids laughing at me. I was heartbroken. How could God take a boy like that and have him stand and read scripture church? How could you take a boy like that and ask him to preach to his people? Well, God can take the below average and do things that no one ever thought. I had a counselor in junior high school that told my parents that he's not going to amount to anything. He's not going to be able to go to university. He's not going to be able to do any of those things because he's just not smart enough. That's what they told my parents. My dad told her that if he wants to go to university, he can sit in grade 9 for the next 5 years until he figures it all out. Because he wants to pass me on, right? and sing a solo as I've done in the past, or do those kinds of things. But God can do things that we never thought possible. God can use you. God can take you from that lukewarm and make you on fire and do amazing things for Him if you just trust Him with it. Will you do that?